Good afternoon and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night and we are live. Don't even know what day I was going to say. I was going to say Wednesday night.
Wednesday. Anyway,
as you can see, I'm joined by everybody tonight. Everybody is here. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Have you all been?
Yeah, pretty good.
Fine.
Yeah. All right. I'm not allowed to ask. You're supposed
just
to
lovely.
Chris, I've been fantastic.
Good, thank you. That's what I was looking for. So yes, to those of you who have not seen the show before, we are four guys from the north of England that do a bit of a games talk show every most Wednesdays at about 7:30 GMT, and we're only a few minutes late today, which is all good. Generally, we talk about which games that we've played within the week or within the last few weeks. I've only really played one game, even though I've got a big list. They're games that I've played from before Fallout 4 came out. I've just been playing Fallout 4. My wife hasn't seen me. In fact, I've been playing it that much. And I'm presuming everyone but Lou is in the same situation.
I definitely am.
Steve?
Kind of. I've only actually put about 34 hours into it.
That's still.
It's a lot, more than granted, me. But it's nowhere near as much as I put into the likes of The Witcher, say, or even Mad Max.
So why is that then?
I was saying to Sam before the stream started, I think it's just because I know that when I sit down in front of it, I'm going to be there for a long time. So I think I'm withholding until I've got a good chunk of time to play it.
Yeah.
Shouldn't a really great game make the time?
I've made time for the game myself. When I say made time, I've got plenty of other things I could be getting on with, but I have to be honest, I've lost myself entirely in the settlement building. Absolutely.
That weeks ago.
I know. Even though it's not the best building in any, you know, in a game ever, but there's something about the fact that it. I know a lot of people have criticised it and said that it's kind of bolted on, but it really feels right for the game for me, and it feels like it's a real good fit, because you're building settlements and people come to the settlements and you gather junk to build the settlements and upgrade your weapon, and it just feels like it fits into the game really well. And as soon as you get, I don't know, maybe six or seven settlements, you start getting attacked by raiders and super mutants and gunners and all these other different things, and there's all these little tiny events that occur, and there seems to be, at the moment I'm not entirely sure, but there seems to be a never-ending stream of quests from the Minutemen for settlements as well.
Well, one thing I was going to bring up is that this, I've had a couple of repeated ones as well.
So have I.
Where it's like, I've done this, like, can I not just leave this settlement to run by itself for 5 minutes now?
I don't mind, you know, someone's been captured, but I've only had two of those. But I've had quite a lot of, can you go and help this? In fact, it feels a little bit buggy in that respect, because I've had a few that have said, can you go and help, I don't know, Sanctuary Hills? And then once you've helped them, you go back to Preston Garvey and the Minutemen, and you say to him, even though it's just a line of dialogue, but he says something like, I've rescued that settler, or I've helped him with the raider problem at this settlement. They're going to join the Minutemen. And it's like, they're already part of the Minutemen. We've already established that in three quests ago. So what's going on here, you know?
Are these kind of procedural quests that are being generated from the settlement set?
No. There seems to be two or three streams of Minutemen quests. And I'm not sure which ones. I think there's one main arc, and then there's a. Then there seems to be two. They're not procedural, but they seem to be persistent, seem to keep going. As soon as you go back to the main guy who gives you your quest, he then gives you another one and says, this settlement's getting has problem with raiders, so you go and speak to someone at the settlement, they send you off. Sometimes it's a brand new settlement, but I think I've either got all of the settlements, which I don't think so yet, or I've got to a point in the main story where I'm not getting any more settlements until I've done something. I don't know. I don't seem to be getting any new settlements now.
Okay. Really? Because how many have you got? Because I've got a lot of settlements, like, and they keep giving me more and more and more all over the map. Like, I don't know how many I've got that counted, but it must be getting on for like 20 something now.
I've got a few more than 20, but not many more than 20. But that's, I mean, it's, okay. It's definitely enough for me to, you know, I've got all of them built up to almost the max, apart from maybe Sanctuary, because Sanctuary's got a huge object limit. Each settlement has a draw call and an object limit, and a, sorry, an averts limit. And I've actually hacked a few of them with a console and up to the limit.
Yeah, averts limit.
Averts
limit. Can't the vertices of the object.
Yeah, so basically, it's to stop the game crashing. Now, on PC, what you can do is you can put in a there's two console commands you can use to up both of those. So I've got, for example, there's Hangman's Alley in the middle of Diamond City, which is only a tiny little settlement. But I started building a really tall tower in the middle of the city, and I thought, oh, this is going to be cool. Then I reached the limit, and I was like, well, my computer's still, it's still 60 FPS. I'm not having any problems with it, so what's the problem? Anyway, I upped it up to the draw count, and it's I've built this humongous tower now in the middle of Diamond City, and it's not a problem. I'm still getting 60 FPS, but it's all to do with the amount of things that are on the screen at a time. That's what a draw call is. So
yeah.
each object that gets sent to the GPU to get rendered onto the screen. But yeah, so I've done that in a fair few settlements, and it's mostly the small ones. Sanctuary, I've not needed to do it yet. There's also a few times I've had to hack a few things, because I think, I don't know if I said it last week, but one of my merchants, Sanctuary got attacked, and one of my merchants at Sanctuary, Trashcan Carla, decided to nick my set of T51 power armor. She got in it, right? And she, I don't know if this has happened to any of you guys or not, but she got in that, and then somebody else, a settler, got in another set of power armor, which was just a frame with a few raider bits on it. I only had two sets then. He ran off into the distance and started attacking the raiders. I didn't see him, and I thought, well, I'll get him later, you know, he'll come out of it or whatever. And she kind of did a bit, got a flamer out, blasted someone, and then just stood there in this armor. And I was like, I spoke to her. No option whatsoever for it to get out of it. Went to try and find the settler. The settler wasn't in it. So then I spent about an hour running around Sanctuary and the surrounding area to try and find this power armor. It was right where it bloody parked. It was behind a wall right next to where they put it, where they got into it. So now I've made a little raised platform where I take the ladder away so they can't get in it every time. Apparently, if you take the power cores out of them as well, they don't get in them. But the only way to get Trashcan Carla out of the power armor is to pickpocket her, and I don't have a very good pickpocket skill because I don't play Fallout games like that.
You pickpocket her out of the armor.
You pickpocket the fusion core out of the armor, and she'll get out of it. But I haven't done that because I don't have a pickpocket skill. I was actually considering hacking the console again, giving myself maximum pickpocket so I could get it off her, and then putting it back down. But I thought, no, I'll probably break something in the perk system, and I don't really want to do that. So I didn't bother. So what I did do is opened her. There's another console command. Again, this is the beauty of PCs. And I wouldn't have done this if it wasn't bugged. This is a bug that I'm trying to get around. Was to open her inventory so you're not stealing off her, so you're not pickpocketing. For some reason, in this particular, there's a console command to do that. For this particular UI, you can't see the fusion core, but you can see all of the pieces of power armor. So you take all the power armor pieces off her, and then she's just walking around in this frame. So I've got the trash can car just walking around in a frame.
Looks like some weird quadriplegic robot bionic woman.
But apparently raiders and everything but super mutants essentially can get in your power armor. So I've made
there's
a whole
Deathclaw in power armor.
Well, oh my god,
humans.
Have you
so basically take the fusion cores out of your power armor when you're not in it?
Yes. Good. Well.
Good tip, because I haven't been doing that.
Well, no, neither have I, but I've now also got a garage. I take the fusion cores out, but I've also got a garage that's raised off the ground, and I take the ladder away every single time I leave it and close the door, because I'm like, I've got must have about 10 or 15 sets of power armor now, and it's annoying. I was just whittering, go on.
What I was going to say was I was actually watching somebody else has been doing like a let's play of it, like someone that I watch on YouTube a fair bit. And, you know, he said that Fallout 3 was his favourite game of the last generation. And that he thinks that Fallout 4 is really, really good, but it's a few things that it's lacking that Fallout 3 had. And one of them, which I didn't really think about until he brought it up, and this might be to do with the fact that I've done a lot of settlement stuff and not as many quests, but of the quests that I've done, a lot of the quests are just go here, kill stuff, get a chest at the end of it.
Yeah,
there's not as interesting quest design as there was in Fallout 3. For example, the Oasis quest, where you see that guy who turned into a tree speak to all the people who have different opinions about it, speak to him. And then you get the three different options of what you can do. You can kill him, you can do this, that, and the other, you can convince him to do... You know what I mean? It's like there's quite a few different options for you to approach quests. Most of these quests is go here, kill this thing, the legendary whatever that you find at the end of the tunnel, basically, and get a quest when you do it, get a chest when you do it. That's pretty much what all the quests have been like.
I agree, and I also have come across a few unique quests, but they're usually to do with your followers and your companions and things to do, you know, either advancing your relationship with them, which isn't that intricate, or finding them in the first place. And there's a few like rescue mission quests or special weapon quests, you know, you get a junk jet or go and get a every single one that's been interesting has been either to get a brand new companion or to help my companion do something. And bloody hell, I'm still pissed off with the companions getting in front of you. Every option, every possible opportunity. That guy, just then, on that...
I saw that when you shot him, when you walked in front of you and he blundered in front of you like an idiot.
I've had that problem as well with the settlers. When something gets attacked, and I go... So I'm like the fucking general of the Minutemen, yeah? I'm walking up. I'm at the castle, which is one of the settlements you can get as you advance. Yep. Got big walls around it, as the name suggests. So these Venice were attacking, so I was like, right, I'm going up here and I'm going to shoot them down. So here I am, looking through my crosshairs, so I'd have any bit more vision, and some settler ran in front of me as I was shooting, and then got aggroed against me, and then everybody started shooting me in the settlement. It's like, I fucking built this settlement, who the fuck do you think you are? So I killed them all.
You know what happened to me quite a lot, because now I've got, I think I've, if you can see on that screenshot, I've got 46 power cores, so I've got tons of them, plus I've got the perk that takes it down to, I think it the last twice as long. So I'm hardly running out of them, and I'm in my power armor constantly now. So the problem is, because I'm in my power armor nearly all the time, and I've not got falling damage, I can jump off anything. So you can jump off the biggest skyscraper and land, and you don't take any damage. But the problem is if I do that in a settlement, it damages people around you. So I keep doing that, and the second time that you damage somebody, they aggro against you. So I'm constantly saving and like reloading and going, fuck's sake, you can't put your weapon away as well after the second time. They'll just keep attacking.
It's kind of your fault for building huge towers to jump off, isn't it, really, Chris?
Oh, it's only that one place I built a huge tower. But yeah, it's... I've got my foibles with it. I've got my issues with it. And I have to be honest, after 110 hours, 120 hours now, Jesus. I think I might be getting a bit bored of it. Even though I haven't even touched the main quest yet, I literally have done two things. I haven't touched anything since last time we spoke a couple of weeks ago in the main quest. And I've been doing all the Minutemen stuff. The Brotherhood of Steel stuff.
Brotherhood's started to get a bit interesting for me now, which is quite good. I think maybe you have to make yourself do a little bit more of the story stuff and mix it up. Because, if you're just doing the settlement building, it is. I think maybe that's maybe my issue, that I've not done that many story quests. I've done a lot of faffing around in the world and Minutemen quests, which are all the same. Go and get a settlement, kill the ghouls at the settlement, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
There's a lot of ghouls in this game. Were there as many ghouls in Fallout 3? There just seems to be fucking ghouls everywhere in this game.
I've not come across many since yet, and yeah, there's plenty of ghouls, but to be fair, I see more raiders than anything.
Yeah, but I kind of expect that, though, because raiders are like the standard... background enemy, aren't they, of just twats in the wasteland. What I've always thought was weird about these games is how, if you want to be evil, why can't you go and join the raiders? They must recruit people. Like, they're always your enemy, no matter how bad you are. You're always against the raiders.
There's quite a lot of different factions of raiders in this as well. There's the gunners, obviously, they're military, but they're still raiders. There's the normal raiders, then there's the what are they called? The Forged are in it. Have you come across them yet? The Forged?
Aren't they just at a forge? Like a certain sect of raiders at a forge?
Yeah, well, there's still different factions, and they will fight against raiders as well if raiders come near them. And then there's the super mutants, and then there's lots of different types of super mutants as well, which all add... I think the variation of enemies is fairly interesting, I've got to be honest with you.
You have to use on them... I have to say, all the big enemies that are meant to be really scary, like Deathclaws, aren't as scary as those fucking blood bugs that like are really fast.
You can't.
You've not got enough action points in VATS. You cannot fucking shoot them. They're too quick. Like I played on a console as well, remember? So I don't have the dexterity of the mouse control that you guys have. And they're just so nippy, and they keep getting on me and sucking me, and it's like, just fuck up! So I get the shotgun out, and I'm just like firing wildly. But like, you have to get really close to them to hit them, at which point they've already attacked you about 12 times. They're like the hardest enemies in the game, no shit. Because there's always about 12 of them together as well, it seems. Never on their own.
Yeah, I haven't seen an excess of ghouls. I'm fighting some right now, but...
So, in the footage you've got there, have you got some sort of mod that highlights enemies or something? Because they've all got this orange glow around them.
There's a few different mods that do that kind of thing, a few different chems and that. But no, I've got a visor, HUD, heads-up display on my power armor. I've got everything but the blacksmith perks that allow me to upgrade my power armor to full throttle. I've got the jetpack and everything. It's actually really quite cool once you've got a lot of action points. But I've maxed out my power armor. Until I get a set of T60, I can't really do anything else. And when I get T60, all the mods are the same as well. So it's not really going to be much more apart from I've got a little bit more health on this next set of power armor, you know. I think I've got XO1 power armor at the moment. But yeah. So, Steve, what do you think of it? Because you haven't really said, but you weren't on last week's show and you haven't said much about Fallout 4.
I'm quite enjoying this, like I said. I just haven't really spent as much time as I'd like to with it. I find that I am getting overburdened quite a lot.
Yeah. When you get the power armor stuff going, though, I mean, I've now got 480 odd carry weight, plus I don't usually put loads into my strength. Sorry, I usually put loads into my strength, but I haven't this time, and I've done it all in endurance because I was sick of running out of breath while I was trying to run away from rad scorpions when I was level 1 getting fucked by them.
It's fun, and when I play I do enjoy it. It's very atmospheric. It can be quite annoying in places. Like the NPCs can be quite annoying. I found the companions to be, all but the dog, to be very annoying.
The dog's only not annoying because he's small.
Yeah, and he doesn't speak to you.
But he still does get in the fucking way.
I've constantly got a shortage of adhesive.
You know, you right.
You can tag components as well.
Yeah, I've now tagged everything in the game, so everything highlights. But I've also got another mod that highlights everything in the game itself as well. So I can see. You can't see it on this video, but I think the last video you could see all of the objects on the floor were all bright yellow.
What I mean is, in the Pip-Boy menu, you can go to your junk and then go to component view and tag. Say you're looking for adhesive. Yeah. Anything that's got adhesive in it that you look at, it'll have a little magnifying glass.
Oh yeah, yeah,
which is quite handy.
Yeah, but I am just literally constantly short of adhesive. I've got loads of every other type of material.
You know what? If it spoils your enjoyment, there are console commands you can use to give yourself those items.
I mean, I can get the stuff. You know, you can make adhesive out of vegetable starch. You can pick it up by, you know, any amount of things. But it's just a constant short at the minute. I'm sure that'll change once I start establishing more settlements and get people to grow the ingredients for it.
You just said the word there that comes to mind when I was playing this, which was it feels like a chore.
The game itself doesn't feel like a chore at the
beginning. Not the game so much, but it's the way, it's the hoops you've got to jump through to get to the menus, to manage the settlement. It all feels like it's really more difficult than it needs to be.
There's also, I was actually going to put a video together that explains all of the ins and outs of the settlement stuff, because it's taken me over 100 hours to figure out how all of it works. There's not very much in the way of the menu. Even the menus are lacking, you know, even the help files are lacking. I found something out yesterday, which I thought was true, but it isn't, that you could hang light bulbs on the wires, which you can't do
it. Yeah, I saw the screenshot for it.
I was like, fucking hell, that's amazing, that'd be brilliant, but you can't do it.
Yeah.
You don't really need lights anywhere. I find that, like, they're just there for aesthetic value. They don't actually serve any purpose.
Well, they do. They light things up.
You can see without them, though. It's not that dark. It really isn't.
I do find the whole Pip-Boy thing annoying as well.
It's really annoying, isn't it? I don't remember it being annoying in Fallout 3, but it's such a...
Yeah, I didn't really play that much.
Pain in the ass.
It's like, if I want to like equip something, I don't. It just seems an annoyance, whereas in like Skyrim or Oblivion, you know, it just brought up a menu, not something that's supposed to, you know, be an interactive menu in the game type of thing.
Do you remember the UI in Skyrim being fucking awful though when it launched?
And no.
It was, in my opinion, it was probably one of the worst UIs I've ever come across in a game ever. And I had
people did have problems with it. I remember that.
It was just clumsy and awful. And it was built for consoles. It was built for using a control pad and holding down buttons while you press other buttons to shortcut to things. This has got, obviously it's got the favourites menu, which I use just for my weapons and the stim pack. That's it.
Yeah.
But when the mods start coming out for the game, I think then we'll have a good interface because somebody will design better than they've put. Simple things like right now we're looking at I'm transferring some stuff to my companion. You can't see how much is in your list. It could be an infinite list for all I know. I just want a scroll bar just to tell me it's this much longer, you know. Little things like that. It's awful user experience.
When I've got my home base at Sanctuary, where I've got chests set up for everything, as I imagine everyone else has as well. And it's just, again, whenever you get back and you're fully laden, you've got to drop everything off. It's like 10, 15 minutes. Because you've got to drop it. And you can't just dump everything in there from like your aid section, because you need some of it. But you want to transfer some of it, and there's no easy way to sort any of it.
Now, do you remember in The Witcher, though? That was also a problem, but they actually started... not The Witcher, sorry. I don't know why I got these two games mixed up. Terraria. actually, Witcher had a problem with the UI as well, and they improved it with merchants. But on Terraria, if you remember, they added a favourites, which was alt-click, and you could drop everything into a chest apart from that. But that is an interface thing, and I don't know why Bethesda keep getting this wrong for PC. People have complained about Bethesda's interfaces since Morrowind, though. I mean, Morrowind was one of the better ones, but it was quite complicated and quite in-depth.
They've got progressively worse.
It's because
the UX in these games has got worse, and UX is a big thing for me.
I totally agree. It's a big thing for everybody because everyone's a user, you know? I mean, one of the things I have to do in my job is UX, you know? You're the same, Lou.
I work in a UX team, yeah.
User experience is a huge thing these days, and with games, the user is the key. There's no... You know, you can't have a game without a user, without a player. And the only thing that I can equate this to is the fact that they are constant. I mean, Sam, what do you think? Because you're on a console. Is it awful on the console as well, or are you getting by with it okay?
It's okay. I can see where you're coming from with your item management. There's a certain amount of faffing around with the menu because you've got so many items. And the sort of management of them can be quite difficult. Like your weapons, for example. Now, I can't be arsed. I'm lazy, but I can't be arsed to rename them all. So once I've got them all modded up and they're different to what they were when I originally got them, it can be quite difficult to find the one that you're actually after really looking at it, mods and stuff, to find out what it is.
That's the first thing that I can think of that is better on the PC, because we can rename it dead quickly with a keyboard. I rename most of my items just to make them easier. I've got most of my armor pieces that I use are called main hyphen something left arm, you know. And I was actually having a conversation with someone on Twitter about this, saying that they were naming the things like Old Bessie and, you know, like cool names, and I was like, well, I just keep, whenever I do that, I'd lose them in my inventory. If I didn't have them favorited, I would lose. I'd give them to somebody, or I'd sell them,
Well, I got into the habit in Skyrim of naming things in a shorthand way that I knew what it was like.
Yeah.
If I'd got a greatsword and then I'd put fire enchantment on it, I'd call it Flaming Greatsword, whatever, just that's shorthand. I just haven't been asked to do that in this game too much. The Pip-Boy, it's kind of like, it's a bit clunky, but I don't really know what their other options are. when they've got this many items in the game that are actually useful to you. Like, I don't really know what the scrolling down thing. I understand that could be useful, but there's so many items. Maybe that's the problem, that there are too many. There's too much shit.
Probably, yeah.
There's better ways to do this, though. I mean, it's just little things I can think of, for example. Yeah. I've got two sets of armor that I use, and that's a choice that I've made. Not everybody does that. And my main set is my combat armor and my synth stuff or whatever, which is where I'm up to in the game. I don't know if that's the best. I don't know if...
Yeah, I've got combat armor.
But then there's also... I've got a hazmat suit that I picked up from somewhere, which I... It's got 1,000 radiation, I think. But when I equip that, all of my other items, like all, what is it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pieces of armor, all get it unequipped. And I have no way to re-equip them without finding them in the menu. And that's why I've named them all main, so they're all in one place, you know?
And you can't have an armor set, as it were.
Why can't you just have a series of subfolders?
That's the thing. Organizing things.
A loadout. Oh, do you know what I was going to bring up then? Metal Gear Solid 5's menu UI has a lot of this. There's a lot of weapons and shit and stuff to choose from, but you can customize it more. So you can have a loadout, but you can have like 3 loadouts, but you can also have your different custom slots as well. So you just go, here's heavy armor loadout, here's sniping loadout, here's this loadout, and just fucking go.
I've got my own problems with Metal Gear Solid's interface, but it is a lot better, and it has a similar kind of problem. Not the same, because you don't have such a micromanaging aspect of all the junk. I mean, the junk's easy to manage. You must know that. You must have seen the deposit all junk
button.
Transfer
all junk.
Yeah. That's it, transfer. But
and if you've got your supply lines up, that means that all your junk is then accessible at all your workshops, which is pretty much essential.
But it's just the execution of the whole thing.
It's
another area as well, which I find very frustrating, is the mods. In order to have a mod available that you can put it onto one of your weapons, you have to have it in your inventory.
Yeah.
But mods have a
point
weight.
0.5,
You can store them in your workshops. Say at Sanctuary Hills, you've got a weapons bench, an armor bench, or whatever.
Yeah.
All the resources for that, if they're in your workshop, are within your workshop storage. So if you store all your mods in your workshop and then build armor benches, chem stations, and weapons benches at all your places, you can actually get all your resources from there, which means you can do all your modding at all your workshops.
That is a good
feature.
It doesn't
tell you that.
No.
It doesn't tell you that. I had to just figure that out by accident. But now that I know it, it makes it a lot easier because I can mod weapons wherever I am.
What is the point in having all the other different containers then? Because I always like to have all of my, in Morrowind or whatever, glass armor in one container. Well, actually, Morrowind didn't have containers, did it? It started with containers. No, they didn't. Because I remember specifically laying all of my... they had weight limits in the containers, and you couldn't fit an entire set of armor in any container that I remember. But what I did is, they didn't have mannequins either, so I had to lay... I had the Balmora Council Club or something... Balmora, something like that, and I killed all of the people in the house, and I just laid out all of my armor perfectly on the floor in all the rooms in the house. It was ridiculous. I wish I could find the save to show you.
I just would never be able to do anything
such a
like
bell
that.
End. Where were we going with that? Sorry, I went off on track then.
It's just about the frustrations.
Yeah,
but there's also an item management thing where, like, if I am over encumbered and I can't get somewhere, I just leave stuff behind.
You know, there's a perk which I've just got. I've got two perks now, which is brilliant because these, as far as I'm aware, didn't exist in Fallout 3 or in any of the Skyrim games. There's a perk where if you're over encumbered, you can use action points to run. So you basically just have to wait around for a little minute, wait for your action points to regenerate, and then you can run for, I don't know, 20-30 seconds. It's good enough to get out of a building anyway, which is the main problem, isn't it? And then after that, there's the next level of the perk is that you can fast travel while over encumbered, which is thumbs up from me. That's a great addition. I've just got them.
Really handy.
They're really, really handy, especially in this kind of game where all I want to do is collect everything in the world. You know, one thing that's really pissed me off, though, and I can't really remember this happening in Fallout 3, but it is a while since I played it, is that everywhere seems to regenerate everything. All of the enemies, all of the items, most of them, unless it's special items, quite a lot and quite often. And it's like, but I want to be able to complete this game. I want to be able to finish. When it says cleared, I don't want next time I go there for it to not say cleared and then I have to clear it again. My gaming OCD is it's playing havoc with me at the moment.
You were looking that ghoul's ass there.
Yes, yeah. That's exactly what I'm doing. It's a mod I installed.
That ghoul must be easy because it's only a novice lock.
Yeah, he is spacking around at the... having a little Bethesda...
I've seen a lot of that. When you go into a place and you kill somebody and you say, because someone's clipped through the goddamn floor and you can't move them, it's like, well, I'm never coming back to this building again because of that horrendous noise.
So, I will persevere though. I am enjoying it, but I think that the little minor annoyances are maybe putting me off playing as long as I would have.
I decided today that Metal Gear Solid 5 is better. And I'm happy to say that as well. I've really been enjoying it. I probably played more of this, actually, I think, so far, in a much shorter space of time. But I think I've enjoyed MGS, and I still really want to play and finish MGS.
I need to go back and finish it. I said that I wouldn't do this. I said, oh, I bought Fallout 4. I was like, I'll have a quick taste of it. And then that's just fucking like that was like 80 hours of gameplay ago. Like, ridiculous.
Yeah. Okay, so we move on from Fallout then.
Yeah.
Has anyone played anything else?
I have played a few games.
The only thing I've been playing other than Fallout is Max Payne 3.
Oh, yeah, I played that a while ago. I never finished it, though. It was, like, quite good.
Yeah, that's how I would describe it. It is quite good.
I did find one of the things, if we're going to talk about it, I'll quickly say, really cool shooting mechanics, which from Rockstar with Red Dead Redemption and all that, I would expect. I hated the cutscenes, though. The cutscenes are all trying to give you this, like, oh, remember the night before hangover feel, but it's fucking horrible to look at. Like, they've all got this, like, weird filter on them, and there's lots of, like, weird camera sort of almost like double exposure where images shift, but it's, like, every cutscene. It's like, I'm not actually hungover playing this game. Can you please just have a fucking cutscene with, like, a normal camera shot? Like, everything's got this weird filter on it, and, yeah, this shit. But it's every cutscene's like this, and it's like, just can you just dial it back a little bit, please? Apart from that, though, cool, enjoyable game.
Yeah, I've just flicked tough through this, and it's the intro, and it seems to have quite a lot of cutscenes as well. There seems to be a lot of footage.
But it is, I'd say, more story orientated than the other ones.
Why is Max Payne Michael from GTA 5?
Yeah, I was thinking
he looks
that.
A lot like him, doesn't he?
Yeah. I actually had to check before I put it on. I had to just check it wasn't accidentally tagged as GTA 5 as Max Payne at GTA.
Well, I think this came out before GTA 5, so
yeah, it did quite a while before.
But now, even now, it's still quite a beautiful looking game. Like Sam said, the shooting mechanics just make it a joy to play. Especially getting like headshots from right down the other side of an airport with a pistol.
And it has this sort of a cool sort of kill cam, doesn't it? When you get cool headshots in, you get a close up of them going like,
it splats open their eye or something.
Yeah, that kind of shit. A bit like Fallout, actually, in that regard.
That is Max Payne's party piece. It always has been, hasn't it? Yeah. This kind of bullet time shooting mechanics. I haven't completed it yet.
I think I got to like near the last level. I just haven't. For some reason, I think I started playing something else and haven't gone back to it, even though I was enjoying it.
It's not a very long game. I started playing it. I've completed it now, and I've got 8 hours on gameplay recorded on Steam.
It was quite tough, though, from what I remember. Oh. Like, it's quite unforgiving.
Play piano.
Certain sections.
I remember 1 and 2, from what I remember anyway, that they were quite difficult unless you had the bullet time, because you had to top your bullet time up, didn't you, in the first two?
You did this one as well.
Right.
When you're hiding in cover, when people start shooting at you, that builds up your bullet time slowly.
Because it didn't do that. Oh, hang on, did it do that in 1 and 2?
I can't remember.
Anyway, either way, I remember that if you ran out of it, it was actually almost impossible to play because the enemy was very, very accurate and got headshots all the time. Now, it's one of those that's like really low down on my list, but I've always wanted to have a go at.
Yeah, I mean, you said before, Chris, that the whole idea of just running around shooting people doesn't appeal to you that much anymore. This game is that. It's just really fun running around shooting people. It just executes it in an enjoyable way. It's not that much more to it than that, though.
But I really enjoyed Vanquish, and that is just gratuitous running around shooting each other and sliding around.
But with
your
rockets
balls.
On your pants, yeah. That's the edge that game has got.
Anyway.
It's true, though.
But, yeah. Fun.
Anything else you played?
No.
Okay, fair enough. Well, apart from lots and lots and lots of Fallout 4, I've been playing only a few weeks ago before Fallout 4 came out. I'm not going to play any video for them, but obviously we played some Keep Talking, Nobody Explodes. I played a little bit more with Sal. I've been playing quite a lot of that Downwell game, you know, that...
The
black and red
one.
Yeah, the black and red one. It's just fun. It's like a fun arcade. It's like I remember putting 10 pence in at the ice skating ring and just playing an arcade. It feels like that, and I'm quite enjoying it. And it's, I mean, what was it? $1.99 or something? $2.99 on Steam. It's a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Been playing Bioshock as well, still with the wife. I just said playing it on Friday nights, going through that again.
How far are you into that now, just out of interest?
So I've just got the telekinesis plasmid, and I've fought maybe two or three big daddies after that.
Oh, so quite near the beginning still.
I'm still quite near the beginning. I find it a bit laborious. It's the PC implementation's awful. The mouse acceleration is very difficult to control and turn off properly, and I find that quite unnerving. Plus, whenever anything happens on my laptop for some reason, you alt tab out of it and then it crashes, so it's just like argh. Xenonauts, I've been playing a little bit, not much more of that. Metal Gear Solid I haven't really touched for weeks now since Fallout came out, and I've just today been playing the Banner Saga, and the only reason that I've been playing this is because I saw a Video Game Nation last Sunday on TV, and they briefly flashed a screenshot, a bit of footage on the screen of it, and I was like, oh, I've got that. That's what it's like. That looks really cool, and it's turn-based kind of fantasy. It's a cross between, you know, the those books that you used to play as a kid, the Dungeons and Dragons books that you rolled a dice for that kind of thing. I have a nightmare book that does that's the same kind of thing. I played to death and all the pages have fallen out of it.
Lone Wolf and stuff.
Yeah. I used to get them out of the library and absolutely destroy them. I loved them. But anyway, it's a cross between that, a bit of Dragon's Lair in there, with a turn-based combat game in it. And I've played maybe an hour of it today. There's a lot of dialogue, a hell of a lot of dialogue in it. But the turn-based gameplay is actually quite cool, and it's very... It's, again, a cross between like the XCOM-type style with a bit of a twist in terms of, instead of playing, you move all of your characters and then they move all theirs, you play it in a... You choose which order your characters go in, but you play a character, then they play a character, then you play a character, then they... There's lots of different skills, there's lots of different... there's lots of different abilities, etc. And there seems to be also a kind of a resource management thing going on in the background. It's an indie game, I believe. It's 2D, and it's one of those games that if you're not prepared to read a hell of a lot of text and get involved in the lore, then it's not really worth playing for you, I think.
But it's quite a classic CRPG sort of thing, isn't it? It's a bit like Warsong, Langrisser style. Yeah. Stuff like RPG layered with some strategy.
Yeah, and it's, I think... And I haven't quite played it enough to really tell if this is the case yet, but I think as you play, the decisions you make will kill off certain characters and will make quite drastic changes in the story. There's a map as well that allows you to choose. For example, I was at a cross. Sorry, I got attacked by somebody. Some enemies. I haven't figured the lore out yet, so I can't really quote types of enemies, etc. But I got attacked by some enemies, and then after the fight I had a conversation with a person who I who was fighting with me, and you've got three options. You've got either run away now, so that before they come and get you, try and get your supplies back from the road where the enemies have scattered them everywhere, or say something else like, "Are you sure you're all right with this? Can we? Do you want to go and get the supplies?" Which probably, if I chose that option, I probably would have been sent into another fight with less health and probably died. Whereas the second option, the option was let's get the supplies quickly and run off. I did that and then managed to get away and get some extra supplies. So there's a resource management aspect as well. Over a certain number of days, you've got a certain number of supplies to use. It's to me so far quite good. I haven't played enough of it to like properly review it, but I'm quite enjoying it so far. Now,
do you play as this old man that we're seeing here?
That one there. That's your main guy. You're Vern. I don't know. You're a giant, basically.
Vern Troyer's not a giant.
Humans take up one square on the grid when you're fighting. These giants take up four squares on the grid, but you play with humans, giants, and probably lots of other types of units as the game progresses as well, I imagine. It seems to be quite in depth, and I think it's going to be one of those games that might take quite a while because the map is huge and it takes you ages to get from one place to another, so we'll see.
There's a sequel coming out soon, isn't there?
Is there?
According to Steam, yeah, it just says available winter. Banner Saga 2.
There's the map. So again, all these different areas you can visit, and that little circle on the left-hand side, that's you. Just trying to find some fighting. So you can also choose all your characters that you're going to use and choose skills and promote them with renown, etc. I imagine the more renown you've got, the more people will know you. And you have to manage your army as you cross the world too.
Everyone's sleeve is doing this.
Yeah, that's quite distracting.
I don't think there's much effort gone into the animation.
Although there is some of the animations when you showed the characters then look quite nice. They did have that sort of Don Bluth Disney kind of look to them. So it was an indie game. Is it quite a sort of low budget one, I'm guessing?
Well, yeah, I don't know how. I mean, it's been around for a while. I got it in a Humble Bundle years ago. Maybe about a year ago, actually. And it's very strategic so far. It's very easy to die if you're not paying attention. The main playing mechanic is you've got armor and you've got health. If you've got 10 armor, or if your enemy's got 10 armor, then that will negate how much health you're going to take off them, so you have to knock their armor down before you can take their health down. But depending on how much willpower and endurance and everything else your characters... It's an RPG to an extent, but it's a bit different. I'm quite enjoying it. I think I'm going to play it a fair amount more. But yeah, apart from that, nothing else. Fallout 4. So when are you going to play some more games then, Lou?
So I've not really played many games at home, but I actually went to an event on Saturday called Retro Revival in Wolverhampton, just outside Birmingham.
Right.
And basically, if you can imagine a cross between an old computer fair and a LAN party... There was loads of people selling old games, massive boxes of PlayStation games, N64 games, SNES games, box consoles. But then in the middle, they had loads of TVs, portable TVs, set up with old consoles and computers connected to them.
That sounds
and you could just sit down and play them.
That sounds just like the retro thing that I went to in Blackpool last year.
Right.
Can't remember the name of it, but it wasn't Retro Revival.
There's probably a few of these things,
yeah.
But it was good fun. There was a tournament there on linked up PlayStation 1s.
What tournament was it?
Basically, there's a choice of 10 games. You'd pick the game out of the hat, and then you'd play that game with an opponent. Unfortunately, it ran over, and I could only stay for one day. And the tournament was going to be the next day, but the finale would be played on the entryway on PlayStation Doom. Do you know what the prize was, Steve? John Romero signed copy of PlayStation Doom.
Oh, that'd have been nice.
Wanted it so much, but I couldn't stay to play it. And I think I would have been in a chance. Either me or Ozzy would have won it.
That's so frustrating.
It was really frustrating.
So, did you buy any consoles while you were there?
I didn't, no. There was not... to be honest, I've forgotten what consoles we had. But there's a fair few things there. There were some really nice box examples. And it was nice, really, just to sit down with a CRT and an original machine,
yeah.
Open the tape deck, put a tape in, play it, and, you know, it was really... It took me back. It really did. Like Chris says, there's a lot of these sort of events going on around the world, certainly around this country. So I heartily recommend that you get yourself along to one, although you may end up buying a TV.
The one I went to, I actually felt quite uncomfortable there for the main reason being there was a whole area that was full of old arcade machines that were all free to play.
Yeah, they had this as well.
There was a whole area full of old consoles and old computers that all had games loaded into. I mean, there was like hundreds of them. In fact, there was two different areas. Then there was a LAN area in the whole back section where people were playing on all kinds of consoles, all kinds of computers, and all kinds of games. People were playing Quake 2 there, and Quake World, and Doom, and, you know, it was ridiculous. It was brilliant at the same time. There was also people playing. There was also a competition on, and then there was an indie games area as well, where there was a lot of indie studios that were promoting the games. I actually went down specifically to network with some of the indie studios and speak to a few people that I'd been speaking to on Twitter previously, and I got to meet some faces and stuff. It was really nice. There was also lots of old retro console stores selling consoles, games, and things like that. I presume it's a very, very similar kind of thing. From what I can tell, I really can't remember the name of it, and I should know it. But whenever it's in Blackpool again, I'm going to go, and you know, you guys are welcome to come over for it if it's appropriate for you guys. It was like 10-15 quid or something to get in, and it was free games all day. But I went on my own, you know, and it's not the same. It's not as much fun if you're on your own. If I'd have been with some friends, it'd have been very different. I'd have probably played some games. As it stood, all I played was a very old version of a very old and clanky version on a old arcade machine of Star Wars, and it was the jet bike game, you know, the isometric one that went
diagonally.
That's the only thing I played, and I think I sat down and played Manic Miner as well on the Commodore 64. That was there.
I would have been on the arcade machines like a fly on shit,
mate. There was so many as well. There were so many people playing them, and I couldn't on my own. It was just, it just didn't feel right. That's why I felt uncomfortable, you know. And I
you want to get like Turtles in Time or whatever it was, and I get like two of you on there. That's what you need. Yeah. Didn't some of those consoles have up to like four players? Some of the arcade machines would have like four players.
Yeah,
Turtles in Time did, and so did.
Simpsons.
So did the Simpsons game, a lot of the X-Men games, quite a few of the.
Yeah.
I think Final Fight, the arcade had four player.
No, I think that was two player.
I think the Mega Drive version was two player, but I think
there might have been a sequel, because I've got a feeling there was only three characters in the first game. So, who would the fourth one have been?
No, maybe
I could be wrong about that. It's like Hagar, the other guy, and the other guy.
A lot of those type of fighting games, anyway, were four player.
Yeah.
You know, some of my best memories as gaming memories as a kid were going into arcade machines. Going into arcades, fucking Flynn's arcade. Going into arcades and somebody, like some kid getting pulled away by his mum, getting told off, and having like £2 left in the arcade, and I'd just play for the rest of the afternoon. On his money, it'd be brilliant.
One of the things that was cool about arcade machines back in the day was also that a lot of the games that I would want and would then go on to own on my Mega Drive would be out first on the arcade.
Yeah.
Even into the PlayStation era, the Tekken games were out on the arcade before you could get it at home.
Yeah, so I played Tekken like, 3 on the arcade. That was fantastic.
Oh man, like it's so much fun. The idea that you could go and play a game in the arcade, which you knew you were getting rinsed for, but the difficulty was jacked up to like ultra hard,
ridiculous.
But then you'd be like, "Oh, I could probably buy this game on my PlayStation in like a few months' time," and that was a cool thing.
But they were always slightly different. It's like the SNES version and the Mega Drive version were always different as well. They were done by different studios quite often, and they had different implementations, and they didn't play the same. And that was back then. There was actually a war between consoles. You know, that divide existed, right?
Although there was a tangible difference between the hardware.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, there were noticeable differences between hardware. They weren't just slightly faster or slower than each other.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. It was distinctly different from what it is now. It's like it literally doesn't matter. You choose your console. If you're a console gamer, you choose your console based on if probably its online capabilities or its social...
Exclusives.
Yeah.
Exclusives, basically, isn't it?
Exclusives, I'd say. That's the basis on which I did make my decision.
There isn't that many these days, though, is there? I mean, I can't remember the last exclusive.
That's the biggest distinction between consoles, though, isn't it? You either have the controllers or the exclusives.
Timed exclusives. That's what it is.
Well, not really, because I'd say, like, Naughty Dog pretty much develop exclusively for Sony. So any Last of Us or Uncharted or whatever games they produce are going to be on the Sony console.
I don't really consider them a game studio, so...
Well, there you go.
Bit of trolling.
But at Red Dead Revival, the games that were the kind of highlights, I played Point Blank on the PlayStation and the arcade for the first time. What a fantastic little game. So many different... basically, it's a shooting game. You got a gun con. And it's just tons and tons of mini games that all involve shooting. And things like there's a maths game where you get shown a sum and you've got to shoot the right answer for the sum and stuff. Brilliant fun. So much fun.
They're fun, but they're bloody annoying as well at the same time.
Well, they were good fun. And we also played some Link of Doom, which is brilliant. As soon as I got the controller in my hand, I was playing like I used to, including holding square to run around everywhere.
What, you mean like a cheating bastard?
Yeah.
Oh, is that cheating?
No, running is not cheating. Running against the walls might be cheating.
It's not cheating if it's in the game, though. It's like circle jumping and rocket jumping is cheating in Quake. You can't say that.
It's cheating when he nicks the health off me and then destroys me with a berserk.
That's cheating. That's better than you.
That's being better, yeah.
Oh, that's cheating.
That's like when I was a kid, I used to play Mortal Kombat with my sisters, and they said if I used the freeze move with Sub-Zero, I was cheating. I was like, no, that's knowing the moves of the game.
What about using leg sweep or uppercut constantly, though?
In the corner.
So that's called being tactical.
That's just called being a dick.
Yeah. If you were betting...
Eddie in Tekken 3 is just cheating.
Eddie's shit. He's one of the easiest... Oh, well, we'll get into that. I could play as Jin and destroy anybody playing as Eddie. Back in the day, now I'd be fucking shit at it.
I'm fucking awful at fighting games. I really am. Never been good at them. But
I used to be well good at Tekken. Well proper good.
Yeah, I could basically perfect the original Tekken using Anna. Anna? Yeah,
Anna as well.
No, I was better with Anna than Nina.
Interesting.
But yeah, it was a good event. Get yourself to one.
Yeah, so there's plenty of them, and probably every couple of months somewhere. So I recommend it too. Yeah. Okay, so let's move on. We are retiring our Way of the Exploding list, I believe, unless you guys have any particular ideas, or you want to continue going with it? I think we might have flogged the dead horse.
Might have used up every list in the world.
No, I'm sure there's a lot more lists, but yeah, we were getting a bit daft, like favorite sunset
favorite
in games.
Favorite font on a game screen.
The Namco font, the ubiquitous Namco font.
Favorite title screen cheat code. Yes. Anyway, so let's move straight on to the gaming news and everything else.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so some of this news is quite old, because it's been maybe about 3 or 4 weeks since I put some things in this document.
New to us, goddammit.
Yeah, Metal Gear Online Studio is shut down, 35 jobs lost, and this was maybe about a month ago now. I don't know if there's any updates. Updates: Konami has provided an official statement to GameSpot confirming the closure. Konami's decision to close its Los Angeles studio. So what happened here, from what I remember, I'm not going to read the article again, but Konami bought a studio, or set up a studio in Los Angeles, to do the Metal Gear Online segment of the Metal Gear Solid 5 world. And now they've closed it down, which basically says that they're either consolidating everything into one place, or they're, they really are getting rid of Kojima. Now, the reason I say that is that another piece of news is that Kojima apparently hasn't left Metal Gear, hasn't left Konami. It's a bit of a kick in the teeth, though, to be fair. And it's a little bit cheeky for marketing reasons, I think, isn't it?
It kind of smacks of the disposable nature of game studios that happens these days. You kind of get these studios set up to do a very specific task and they all get laid off so that they don't have to pay them anymore.
That happens on an individual level as well, staff-wise. Contractors get, you
know... It does. This is one of people's chief concerns with the games industry, if you work in the games industry, is this disposable sort of throw lots of people at it and then lay them all off when it's done attitude, rather than really going for talent.
Yeah.
There's a homogenous nature to things now where everyone can kind of do the same thing.
Yeah, I mean, so there's not much more to it than that, but I said this was November the 3rd, so what are we looking at? Like,
so what does this mean? What does this mean for the progression of the online game? And it's still working on it.
This facility contributed to the recent Metal Gear Solid games. Konami will continue its operations to support all Metal Gear Solid titles, including the recently launched Metal Gear Solid 5 Phantom Pain and Metal Gear Online Metal Gear Online. Oh, no, there's a full stop there.
That's
sorry.
A full stop there. Metal Gear Online is meant to be out
that's
in January.
That's a crap subtitle, Chris.
Metal Gear Online is scheduled for release on PC Steam in January 2016. I believe Metal Gear Online is actually already out on consoles. I'm pretty
sure
of that.
It launched a while ago, but I still haven't signed up for the PlayStation Plus. It basically lets you play games online.
Have to be
I'm just not that arse about online multiplayer as a general thing.
I wouldn't bother. I just wouldn't bother. I've played quite a lot of the FOB stuff, the FOB forward operating base stuff, and it's, you know, it's all right, but it's not worth paying for, you know.
From what I've seen, the Metal Gear Online as a game in itself looks like a fairly interesting class-based squad, you know, uses class systems in a squad-based. Shooter, that's what it looks like. That's the basic gameplay of Metal Gear Online. So you pick a certain type of soldier that you are. You have a team and you fight another team in an area kind of game. Like a Team Fortress type thing, but stealthy, I guess.
Yeah.
It looks quite cool, but nothing mind-blowing.
I said I'll have a go, because I think we get it for free on Steam, so we don't have to pay extra to play it. I don't think the only thing we have to pay for, or we could pay for, is we can pay for MB coins, which allow you to buy more forward operating bases and speed things up, I think, but I'm not asked about that.
Bullshit.
Yeah, I've nearly maxed out my first forward operating base and I never get attacked. But that brings me on to another bit of news for Metal Gear Online, Metal Gear Online related stuff, is that Metal Gear 5 nuclear disarmament event is now live. Nuclear.
Thank you.
Fuck's sake, does it matter?
Yes.
I'm quite interested in this because I was going to start developing some nuclear weapons for Metal Gear 5, but apparently there's an incentive now. At a certain point in the game, you'll get special content or you'll get special footage or some weapon or item or event or something will occur if you disarm all of your nuclear weapons. So it's like, what's the point in developing them now? Even though I've never had enough money or fuel resource to actually build them yet. So I'm kind of.
I thought the nuclear weapons thing. Yeah, I haven't had any because apparently you can nick them from other people's bases as well. And I haven't had any yet, so the nuclear armament thing is something that I've not done anything to do with.
No, you won't, because it's part of the FOB stuff. So if you haven't signed up for it and you can't get access to it, you need a FOB first, I believe. I think. I might be wrong there, I'm not sure. It's a while since I played it, to be fair. But
this is one of those things that like pisses me off about current gaming stuff. And I had this issue in Mass Effect 3 as well, in that I've heard that to get a certain type of ending or to get a certain thing to do at the ending, you have to have disarmed some nukes, which means you have to play online. And it's like, what if I just want to play a one-player game? I fucking paid the same as everybody else. I put the time in. Why can't I get the good ending? Mass Effect 3, to get the best ending, you had to have a certain military power, and the only way to get it above the required amount was to play online and earn money by doing co-op missions. I fucking hate that shit. If I want to play a one-player game that's one player, so no, I don't have to play online, I should be able to get the fucking good ending. It's total bollocks.
I agree, but unfortunately the world is online now, isn't it? Everything's connected. The Internet of Things is a thing, unfortunately.
That sounded so
I love the
weird.
Internet, but I like multiplayer games.
Fuck you.
Well, no, I'm sorry. I agree. I 100% agree. But what can we do about it, you know? We've got no control over what they decide to do. And who gives a fuck about this? So, I've I could see all seven endings for Maniac Mansion if I wanted to, but I've only seen six of them. So, you know, I haven't seen that seventh one. I can't really, I'm not that bothered.
I could just look it up on YouTube, but that's not really the point.
I still haven't completed Final Fantasy VIII, with that brilliant final cutscene that everyone keeps telling me about. Yeah, that I've never seen. And I should really just look it up on YouTube, but I haven't.
But you could go back and play that game.
Yes,
no, and get it if you wanted to, without having to fucking play an online co-op mission that you don't want to do.
I could, but can I be asked? That's the point. Anyway, I'm just going to read out the conditions that you have to meet. This might completely nullify your argument here. You must have completed Mission 31. You must not own or be currently developing a nuclear weapon. If you have any nukes in stock, you must dismantle them. Certain conditions related to nuclear proliferation must be met on the regional server for your corresponding gaming platform. So that sounds like you have to be online. Actually, that bit. All nuclear weapons on the regional server corresponding to your console or platform must have been dismantled. In other words, the amount of nukes on your platform server must be equal to zero. So
That's not even in your control, is it?
No. That's the thing. So it's very, very specific to get this content. But it's like a really crazy Easter egg, isn't it? But everybody who wants to play, I think you can switch platforms as well. You can switch servers or something to that effect. So there was some more detail there, but it's not as complicated as it sounds. It sounds like it's harder to get than it is. But then again, this makes me think about Star Wars Galaxies back in the day. You had to spend hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours trying to get this holocube in order to become a Jedi. And when you became a Jedi, your character had permadeath, and everybody on the server wanted to kill you. So it was pointless trying to do it, because you only had it for a second, but you'd spent hours, and then that was it. You had to start again. So, you know, it's up to game developers if they want to put them things in. I'm not that arsed. I didn't ever try and become a Jedi in that game, for example. You know? I don't know.
I think what it says is that no game should ever try and introduce a mechanic which makes someone special, because that will never work. People have to make themselves special by being really good at the game.
I agree with that.
I agree with that. Yeah. But that isn't how it works.
It is, actually.
Well, this is what ties into this whole, again, a recurring moan that we've had that we're probably never going to stop moaning about. Pay to win type shit. You can pay to make yourself more powerful, more special, have better gear. You've earned it because you've been out and had a job in the real world and given that money over. So in that sense, you have earned it, but you've not earned it through being good at the game. Huh? And that Jedi thing, you have earned it, but it's taken away from you so quickly that it's not worth it, is it? Really?
Well, that's only if you chose, again, it was only if you chose to reveal yourself as a Jedi. So if you went out into the wilderness and fought enemies, if someone saw you from a distance and saw, bloody hell, there's a lightsaber flashing around over there, let's go knack him, then you'd probably end up killing that one person, but then they'd tell the entire server and they'd all descend upon you within seconds. Yeah.
It sounds on the face of it like it would be a good idea, but it's actually just lazy design. It's like, we can't be bothered making the game more fun, so we'll just put this in that sounds like it's going to be great.
Makes money. Yeah, gets them to play hours and hours and hours.
Well, I was going to say, what would have made it more fun is if getting the Jedi thing was more readily available, so it wasn't as special, so that you wouldn't just get killed by everybody because there was a few Jedi knocking around, and therefore it was more even, like more level, more enjoyable.
Well, I think they changed the mechanic of Galaxies quite a few times. They changed the entire skill tree system a number of times. I know that. It's probably now, if it even still exists, completely unrecognisable to what I played years back. So, yes, Metal Gear news. That's Metal Gear news done with. We do have some pixel art that we'll...
Yes, yeah.
We can paste into chat if anyone's watching, but... I suppose I can show it on the stream. It's quite nice, actually. Quite nice.
It's very nice, I think.
So we've got some pixel art on pixelartist.com.
It's a website that I follow that just posts pixel art, but I just thought these were really nice renditions.
God, that fucking hamburger thing. It's like this whole sub story of, you get these cassette tapes as you play through the game and you can listen to them. As
you travel around,
there's this whole thing. Yeah, that's his hand gesture. That's his signature fucking gesture.
Does he even do that in 5, though? I haven't seen him do that, I don't think.
I think he does it at the start when he says, like, well, you know, in the first mission when you get to Afghanistan and you've got to go and find Kaz, and he's like, let the legend come to life. I think he does it then. Right. I think he does it then. I'd have to like rewatch that shit. But yeah, the hamburger thing, there's this whole thing between Kaz and Windtalker where they're like, so have you got the recipe? He's like, I tried putting herbs in my hamburgers. And this whole like hamburger conversation, it's got like 7 different chapters to it. And it's absolutely pointless.
But have you been able to listen to anything Code Talker says? Because isn't he the most boring person you've ever heard in your life?
He's got that really old gravelly man voice that's, it's very, very flat. There's not a lot of emotion. It's just like, I was kept in a cell and then a thing and then a virus. Like, it's just that level.
Most of the other tapes are only a few, you know, maybe a minute, 2 minutes long. All of his are like 10 minutes and it's like, for fuck's sake. I want to load the next section now, but I can't because you're still fucking talking.
Unfortunately, a lot of his tapes are also him talking to Skullface, who is also shit. Like, he's probably the worst villain. Yeah, I can say this now, having got to rant in the end of the game, he's probably the worst villain Metal Gear's ever had. I know nothing about him. I don't care about him. He's not fun. He's not even, like, hammy and shit in, like, a hammy way, where I can take the mick out of him. He's just a bit nothing. He's just a nothing villain with a stupid face. There's not really anything else to him than that. He's, even Fat Man is more entertaining than Skullface, and I fucking hated him.
Oh, who's the worst? Okay, so King Digital of Candy Crush Saga fame, to be bought, this is again old news now, but to be bought by Activision Blizzard for $6 billion.
Ooh!
Now, that's a lot of bloody money.
It is a lot of money.
It's a lot of $6 billion. That's more than Facebook was bought for fuck's sake.
But it was.
King make a lot of money, though, that's the thing.
Aren't they on the kind of tail... Yeah, aren't they kind of tailing out now, though?
Well,
but then we thought that about Minecraft, didn't we? We thought that about Mojang, and what Microsoft have actually done is reinvigorated it massively.
They've got story mode now, haven't they? Out, and there's obviously a movie coming out. They're going hard at it.
When this story broke, I remember hearing on the news, it was on the BBC News on my radio one morning, and there was was he a painter or some. Dude is a shareholder in King, and he paid them like 10 quid or something for 12% share, 12.5% stakehold, and he's now just received a check for $480 million. And it's like,
that's the way to do it,
man. These are the kind of edge case stories you hear that I wish I was that person. That'd been awesome.
To be fair, speaking about Minecraft, Notch used to work for King.com and he got a bigger dividend when he sold Mojang.
Yes.
He got $2.5 billion, didn't he? Well, no, he got $1 billion.
But yet there was a huge amount of tax on it as well. He didn't get as much as you think, but
he's still lives in Beverly Hills and he's very unhappy about it.
Yeah. Although he's back in Sweden. Is it Sweden? Netherlands? No, Sweden.
I think he goes between the two, yeah, but... Yeah. He's grossly unhappy about the fact that he's got so much money.
Boo hoo.
Yeah.
Mankind Divided. This is
human.
Deus Ex. Mankind Divided has been delayed. I don't have a problem with this at all. I have to be honest. Again,
yeah,
same thing.
Game delays don't upset me. Shit games upset me that have been rushed out the door. So delay it.
Again, I don't even really have games on my radar at the moment. I'll get a game when I fancy playing it these days. I still haven't played Tomb Raider, the remake.
Does it not worry you that they must have a really, really good reason to delay a game by this much? Because it's delayed till August, isn't it? It's been delayed by 7 or 8 months or something.
They delayed Arkham Asylum for 9 months.
They delayed GTA 5.
Delayed
Duke Nukem. It's a very, very different case, that.
That's an exception that proves the rule, surely.
Steve, you're a little bit quiet. You've moved your mic away. Yeah, I'm not bothered. It doesn't concern me in the slightest. Why would it concern me? What could possibly make it,
the game would have to be very broken or very unfinished for them to be delaying it by that much, which kind of suggests that the game is still going to be a bit wank when it comes out.
What?
I disagree. I think that means that the studio, the publisher, actually said, we'll give you more time to make this right. Again, I use the example of games like Arkham Asylum that got delayed for about 9 months, came out and was fucking awesome.
It was one of the best games. It was easily the best game that year, in fact.
Wasn't it completely broken on PC when it came out, and to the point where they had to retract it?
I don't know, but it came out quite a bit after on PC.
I'm thinking of Arkham Knight.
Yeah, that was the third game in, yeah. Arkham Asylum came out on consoles, and it was a stupendous game. It was, unfortunately, now games like Mad Max and probably every other game that's got a fighting mechanic has now ripped the mechanic straight from it. But
yeah,
it's good.
So yeah, I'm at the camp that I'd rather a game. I said it before. I'd rather a game be delayed than be rushed out and be crap.
Quote from the studio: "The game is a huge part of our lives, and we won't compromise on its quality." Basically, I don't have a problem. I have a problem when Ubisoft would, delay an Assassin's Creed because all they're doing is copy and pasting everything and then putting some new prefabs in there. All of their development time is spent creating models and textures and throwing worlds together.
Yeah, the gameplay doesn't really alter that much, does it?
That's where all of the money from these big AAA games go into it, unless it's a brand new mechanic with new and interesting. It's like even the new Mirror's Edge game, that appeals to me more than quite a lot of games because it's got a different type of mechanic in it. Even though Mirror's Edge did it okay, I think Mirror's Edge 2 is going to improve it a lot and add a lot more into it. You know, add a lot more kind of dynamic combat into the parkour stuff. I'm quite excited about that, I have to be honest. Especially if it comes out on PC, because I'd love to play that on PC. Anyway, no, not bothered. Not bothered about that at all. Lawbreakers. Have you guys heard of Lawbreakers?
I hadn't watched.
It's a new Klifsky FPS game.
Klif Bleszinski.
And he's been going on about it for a while now. It got announced at E3, I think.
Is anyone already getting bored of all of the class-based shooters that are coming out, including the fact that I've realised that the latest Call of Duty is basically a class-based twitchy shooter?
Most Call of Duty games are essentially
New one is like a really sort of arcadey.
Black Ops 3, do you mean?
I think it is, yeah. Yeah, Black Ops 3.
It's actually been received. I mean, I know a lot of them get good reviews because they standardly come out and get, good reviews. But I think the real people, as it were, are sort of enjoying Black Ops 3 a bit more than the others. I don't know what that is, but this looks like kind of fun. But in all these trailers, they always look like they're kind of fun, don't they? Because they use scripted events to make it look cool.
Exactly,
it's a bit like Bulletstorm.
That was exactly what I was going to say. It reminds me of Bulletstorm, and I've wanted a multiplayer Bulletstorm for a while because I really enjoy the single player aspect of that game. But
I'm just going to say that looking at this, I'm not seeing many differences between this and Battleborn and Overwatch. They haven't come out yet, have they? Overwatch is Blizzard's version of this. Battleborn is Gearbox's version of this, and they're all class-based shooters.
But COD's made that popular, that's the thing, and that's what this looks alright. I won't just buy it. I won't buy it at 50 quid, 60 quid or whatever. Certainly won't buy it at 50, 60 quid. But, you know, I might have a go of it, see what it's like. Apparently it's coming out next year as well. And I think it's definitely going to be a multiplayer-based game as well.
Yeah, the multiplayer exclusive pretty much won it. There's going to be a plague of those kind of games coming out next year. There's three that I know of that are coming out.
I'm kind of with you there. I agree, but that one in particular looks like it's got something different. I don't know what that is exactly yet, but we'll see. We'll see.
It looks like they've got some decent separate mechanics for each class type. But again, it's just a short little video. Hard to take much away from it other than the bare, like, basic impression in it, really.
Yeah, so Plague Inc. I think I've spoke to you guys about this a few times. Plague Incorporated. It's actually fairly new news that's come out today, in fact. Plague Inc. is a game. It was a mobile game I've been playing for a while, but it's now out on PC, on Steam as well. And it's you basically evolve a virus to wipe out the population of the planet. And it's a strategy game of some sort. You know, you evolve this virus and then you give it...
Abilities,
and it can transport itself over water, over air, over sea, and depending on which countries you've infected and what type of virus it is, depends on how it spreads. And it's quite interesting. I've really enjoyed it as a casual game, but they've now brought out a multiplayer aspect of it as well, or it's coming out soon.
Did you ever get the zombie update for
that? Yes, I've played it. Have you played the Christmas update as well? New Rax virus or something, and it's just basically you have to make everybody happy. it's like a troll of a troll on viruses. It's again, they've got loads of unique features and unique ways to infect, but it's a strategy game. That's all it is, and it's fun at that, and it's very well done. And the basic premise is to start off with, the first time you play it, you're a virus and you spread normally. You just spread across countries, and you have to infect a certain number of people before you then start spreading into other countries. You can enhance the spread, you can enhance the infection, you can enhance the lethality. But the first time I played it, I killed everyone off within a country before it started spreading into another country. So that was it. The virus was dead. So I didn't actually get out of the first country that I killed. Because I didn't really know how it all worked. But then, obviously, I've got quite good at it now, and I can wipe most of the planet out on most occasions. It's quite good. But I think the multiplayer might be quite interesting on that. If you've played it, Steve, have you played it on Steam?
No, just on mobile.
Because I keep meaning to buy it on Steam because I've enjoyed it so much. I didn't buy it on my mobile, so I thought I might get it on Steam and have a go. But if it's got multiplayer, I think it'd be quite cool to have a go.
That's a new element to it, definitely.
Yeah. Warcraft movie trailer released. This is quite old now, isn't it?
It's a couple of weeks ago, but it's... I don't know if anybody's seen it.
Yeah, we've already talked about this and showed it.
I haven't seen it.
You can't have been on the...
I wasn't on then either, then.
It was just you, Chris, on your own.
It wasn't.
Chris has looked at it and talked to himself about it one night.
Are you absolutely positive? Because I'm almost certain that we've shown this on a couple of episodes ago.
I've seen it, but I didn't watch it with you guys.
I was just interested to see what you guys, who have actually played the game, think of it.
It looked all right to me. I mean, I'm not really that bothered about films these days, though, and especially not films of games and games of films. Oh, actually, this is a different trailer to the one I saw. The one I saw was Lord of Orcs whittering at each other in...
There are orcs in this trailer, there's both. But what the trailer basically shows is that there's a main orc dude and a main human dude, and they have to work together for reasons.
Oh, just realised we'll probably get content tagged for this.
Oh, yeah.
Never mind. It's a fair use, isn't it? We're criticising it. Look at shit.
But it doesn't matter to them, does it? Look at shit.
Did you ever see Dungeons & Dragons back in the early 2000s?
What
it
was?
It just looks like a load of Americans in shit fantasy armour.
To be fair, one of the main actors is Dominic Cooper, and he's British at least, mate, so it's not all Americans.
Okay. Okay. I just see what's her name? Zoe Saldana there?
Sexy
I don't think so. She's not listed in the cast list. I had a quick look at the cast list. It's a lot of actors who you've seen in other things, but they're not big names. Clancy Brown's in it, so that's pretty cool. It's always good to see Clancy Brown in shit doing his big gravelly voice that he does. Clancy Brown, if you don't know who he is by name, is the bad guy from The Highlander, you know?
Right.
He's the really nasty guard in The Shawshank Redemption, that guy. He does a lot of voiceover work. I'm guessing he'll be playing one of the orcs because he's got such an orcish voice anyway.
They've released two of these then, because the one that I've seen isn't this one at all.
The orc designs look like, I know it's designed from the game, but they don't look totally out of place.
Nothing like the game. Sorry, sir. It's really low poly. The game. It's not a particularly high fidelity.
Fundamentally, though, they
game.
Have the big teeth.
The design is the
right.
Same. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's the same as the box art.
Okay, there you go. That'll do.
And the cutscenes from the game.
But what this trailer shows, it's very much humans and orcs. Aren't there loads of like races? I'm sure they've seen some woman with like glowing blue eyes and shit, and the wizards orcs, and dwarves and
gnomes,
shit.
Elves.
The main Warcraft, the original Warcraft was mainly humans Torrent. And orcs, and then they introduced more. Not classes, but races.
So do you think this is how they're going to go in the film? They go, we'll do these two races as the main focal point. Then in World of Warcraft 2, we'll start doing the elves, shit like that. Do you reckon? I mean, if they're going to make a film like this, they're going to have franchise in mind, because they always want to make franchises out of this kind of shit. They always
They will have it in mind, but I can't see that doing well, personally. I've not heard enough about it for it to seem like they're putting a lot of effort into it.
Officially, it looks quite nice from the trailer alone. I can't see it looks like a shitty, low-budget effort. Like, Dungeons & Dragons looked wank. Even for its time, it looked shit. Like, it just looked like it had bad effects. Jeremy Irons giving the most fucking hammy performance that ever hammed a ham on a ham sandwich.
There you go. That's what an orc looks like in World of Warcraft. It looks better than when we used to play it, but it's still...
Yeah, they're dead, haven't they?
But look at
basically
it.
Basically
still...
the same design, though. It's got the same green skin, the big fucking teeth, all that shit.
Yeah. Still very low poly, but yeah, it's not...
Green pigmen, basically, aren't they?
Yeah.
As they should be.
As they should be, yeah.
Green. I don't think anybody gives a shit. I just thought it was like I thought it might be quite a bigger deal amongst the fans of the game. I don't know. I guess not. I've never played Warcraft at all.
You're a bit late to the party, aren't
they? Do they have any fans left? It's the thing.
People still play, yeah. I think the people who still play are the people who are married to other players.
They've stopped announcing officially the playing numbers as well, so that means it's starting to really dwindle off, I think.
I don't know what they've gone to, though. I can't think what is the big MMO.
There's loads of them. Well, the MOBAs are the new MMOs, aren't they?
I was going to say, MOBAs is the big one now, isn't it?
LOL. That's a... League of Legends is huge.
Yeah, but
days.
Is it the same audience?
No,
it's similar. A lot of MMO players have gone to MOBAs.
I find that hard to believe, because MMO players are more social players than they are skill players, and LOL and stuff like that is... very skill based.
Oh, there was a game that Josie and the MMO buff lot were talking about a lot. Oh, War something? War Song? No, not War Song. Oh, I can't remember. I'm not going to sit and try and figure it out. But Wildstar. That was it. Wildstar seems to be getting quite popular, and that's like a futuristic kind of World of Warcraft type game. But there's always MMOs going on. There's loads of them.
Oh, I know there's loads of them, but there's normally one big one. World of Warcraft has been huge for so long that it seems strange that there isn't a replacement for it. Now everyone's kind of scattered off to Elder Scrolls Online and EverQuest, whatever it's called.
Does anybody play Elder Scrolls Online, really? I thought that game was a bit of a flop.
I think it's had a bit of a resurgence since the release that update, whatever it is. I still hear about it. It is a flop, but people still play it.
Alods Online, Dragon's Nest, Defiance, Runes of Magic, Fallen Earth, never heard of any of these, by the way, Uncharted Waters Online, The Secret World, Star Conflict, Raiders,
Star Conflict. That's a terrible name.
Star Trek Online, Terror
I've got
Online.
A name for a game Star Wars has taken, mate. Star Conflict, don't ship it. What the fuck? Seriously?
Aeon Online, Dungeons and Dragons. Scuffle. DC Universe Online as well, that gets quite a lot of mention, especially in the console world.
Yeah, DC Universe Online, I think that did okay for itself.
Neverwinter. Neverwinter gets quite
I've
a lot of
I've heard about Neverwinter, actually.
That EVE Online as well.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Lord of the Rings Online, apparently.
That's been out a long time. I'm
numbers based.
Gutted that Planet Side 2 wasn't better. Planetside probably give me some of the best large-scale gaming experiences of
Planetside 2 has been overhauled a number of times since we last played it. It may be worth giving it another go if you're into that kind of... I'm not an MMO guy.
I don't have the time for an MMO.
Guild Wars 2, Fan Fantasy, fucking XIV, 14, A Realm Reborn, and number one is still World of Warcraft, apparently.
Yeah, I would have thought so.
But it seems like there's a lot more competition. And there's a lot more legit, I guess, competition than there was. I think I got the impression that World of Warcraft was the MMO of its time.
Yeah,
there
yeah.
wasn't really anything else that could compete with it. I suppose a few of those players have now gone off and done other things, like maybe a huge Superman fan was playing World of Warcraft because DC Universe Online hadn't been released yet, and now he's fucked off to play that instead. Maybe that's the explanation.
Yeah,
of it
does feel like it's the kind of a dispersal of the gamers, doesn't it?
Mm.
To the niches.
Maybe.
It okay. shows where we've come from, because we, like, I'm thinking back 10 years ago, 10, 15 years ago, there was only a few big games out. Like, you compare it to the big four of metal, really, it's like, there's more choice now, when it's more dilute.
It's saturated, it really is. I mean, the game, I'm not just talking about the AAA market, that's still, obviously, millions, billions of dollars worth of revenue there, but the indie games market is bigger, and more releases are coming out every day than there's ever been. It's very easy to release a game. Now, a lot of it's trash, but at the same time, there's also a lot of great indie games that are coming out. Great indie games that you can plow hours and hours into. You know, a lot of roguelikes, a lot of procedurally generated games that, fair enough, might take a while to develop, but they still provide hours and hours of gameplay if you've got the right combination, you know, the right recipe.
I guess it also gives the ability for small communities to rise again, which was a great part of old school gaming. In that, even though everyone was playing the same game, there were pockets of communities within those games. Seeing that reappear is certainly welcome to me.
I also feel a little bit like it's kind of got lost as well. At the same time, there's a lot of disparity, and there's a lot of people playing games that probably wouldn't have played games before, if you know what I mean, because it was more difficult. It's a lot more accessible and easier these days with platforms like Steam, with platforms you know, like the console. Consoles are getting more powerful. Consoles that have the capability, that DC, as I said, DC Universe Online, I imagine a lot of their players are console based, because it was released on console first, I think
it was definitely marketed and pushed that way.
It's never appealed to me personally, but you know, Star Wars games did a little bit. I've tried a few of them, kind of got bored of them, moved on. But I stopped playing WoW to move to Star Wars because I preferred it.
Do you know what's funny about DC Universe Online? The premise of DC Universe Online, in that you get to be a new hero who joins the DC Pantheon. I would actually really like that if it was a one-player game, story-based game. And that I could design my own like powers from scratch and go down that upgrade route. I'd actually fucking get into that. I'm just not bothered about massively multiplayer. It just doesn't appeal to me. If they had that same premise but did it one player, and you get to go and hang out with Batman and learn his fucking gadget moves and shit and be one of his apprentices, that'd be quite cool.
But that's it. There's a different marketing technique. It's not sustainable to do a one player game of that.
No, I understand that, but the premise of it I actually quite liked.
What would be your superpower, Sam?
Superpower for me, well, out of the ones they gave you, there wasn't that many. You could be a gadget type, a strength type, or whatever. But if we're doing that conversation, my superpower would be like telekinesis is the one that does everything. So you have that.
You said flying when we've had these conversations before.
Yeah, but if you've got good telekinesis, you use telekinesis to lift yourself off the ground and fly.
Yeah.
All right. Oh, you've thought about it a little bit more since last time.
But I've watched Chronicle. mate.
That
basically covers it.
My superpower would be the ability to grow my beard really long, really quickly.
Wow.
Would you have to cut it manually?
Doesn't matter. That's like my superpower. That's all
I
want.
You have like one of those anime moments where it's like, I have to grow super beard, ah! And you like cover the whole world in beard.
Yep. My beard is 9,000.
You have to like stop a nuclear bomb by covering it in beard and absorbing the blast.
Damn right.
Some beard.
Hey, look, they've never tried it, so they don't know if it's going to work or not.
I could actually probably make quite a lot of good scenarios out of that.
I think my superpower would probably be something like time travel, being able to go back in time.
Oh, like Hiro Nakamura from Heroes.
Not like him, no.
Good.
Oh no, it's the other guy, isn't it? The police guy that does that shits himself every time he pauses time or whatever. What does he do?
What guy are you talking about there?
The guy that looked like Dobbs from the Blue Room.
Oh, he could read people's minds.
Was it reading minds? And he was doing that.
He did that little face thing every time, like a little twitch. To
oh,
show
he didn't do his teeth when he went.
Yeah, he sort of tilted his head a little bit.
Yes, it would be. See? It would definitely be time travel.
Nope. See, what would yours be?
What would my superpower be?
Yeah.
Omniscience.
Ooh. Omniscience.
A little easier to define than omnipotence, isn't it? Because omnipotence comes with all kinds of problems, like could you create something you couldn't move?
Yeah. Or create something that you couldn't destroy and set it up. So yeah, so omniscience. Which I'm pretty much almost there anyway.
But omniscience is just knowing everything, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
So, yeah, quite useful.
Yeah, but
if you know everything about everyone, about anything, you can have total power. So you can travel in time, but I know everything that you know, and I know everything you're gonna do.
Well, you know how to build a time machine as well.
Yeah, because Chris knows.
No. My superpower is time travel. Just because you know that,
and I would know how you got your superpower.
But it would be just a natural superpower. It would just happen.
What he knows is he'd know how to defeat you. That's what he'd
Yeah, that's then. Fine. I understand that. But you wouldn't be able to get my superpower off me just because you've got omniscience. Omnipotence, because then you could take that off me.
No. Omnipotence comes with too many problems.
So,
this isn't a deep philosophical conversation. It's a completely rubbish argument.
I feel like we should be sat in the pub with a pipe. Yeah. Conversation. It's one of those kind of things.
So, Lou, what about you?
I'd have antibiotic wrists.
Antibiotic wrists.
Yeah, I'd be able to cure any bacterial infection with my wrists.
It's very specific.
Why your wrists?
You know in Captain Planet when they had like fire, and it's like water, waves,
antibacterial lotion.
That's Lou. He's like the little heart guy. He's like, yeah, but love could be the most powerful weapon.
Come on, you have to explain deeper than that. You can't.
No,
just get
I'm leaving it at that. There are many things you can do if you can cure diseases with your wrists.
Antibacterial doesn't cure diseases.
Well, it cures.
Otherwise, we'd be sending fucking loads of antibacterial wipes to Africa, wouldn't we, to cure Ebola?
Let's just say that when the superbugs come and everyone's got like bacterial infections, and my wrists still work, I'll make lots of money, and then I'll buy all the gadgets.
I won't, because I'll know it's coming.
But I'll just go back in time before it happened, and then when it happens again, I'll just go back in time again before
it
happens.
And Sam will just fly over.
I'll just fly away and throw buildings at everybody.
Just for fun. No specific reason. Oh, you got super strength as well, have you? You've telekinesis, not just flying. Fuck. That's a good one. I like that. I like telekinesis. I give Sam an internets for that. I think Sam wins the internets for it.
I just want one internet. I'll put it in my pocket for later.
Yeah. Do what you want with that. Telekinesis it. Okay, so the Wii U. Got a bit of news about the Wii U today. On top of what's in the document, which is that the new Legend of Zelda game may be too big for the Wii U, or maybe too power too what big is that the right way to say it?
I think it's hinting at this is about as much as the Wii U can take.
You know what? I think that this article is, and this is complete conjecture because obviously I have no proof. But I think it's possibly a marketing ploy by
sponsored
Nintendo.
Concept.
Yeah, because recently they've been talking about the Wii U not doing very well in sales. They're going to bring out this new Nintendo NX, and they're bringing it out within 3 or 4 years of the Wii U coming out.
You said that the Wii U is not doing so well on sales.
Apparently not.
It's actually topping most sales lists for consoles at the minute. Like in America, Target have named it their top selling item. Wholesale.
So why did they release a new console then?
Why?
Because why it's a commercial failure. That's what they've said. Let me try and find the article.
The Wii U doesn't strike me as something which has done well. I've heard nothing about it, pretty much.
I don't know anybody that's got one.
Like the Wii was a huge breakthrough. The Wii U just seems to have disappeared. For a while, I didn't even realise it was out.
I haven't even really wanted to get it yet. The only reason I would get it is the Zelda release.
What I was going to say was there hasn't been a big flagship Wii U game to say, here's a new console, boom, here's a new... Like, the Wii had Mario Galaxy, not straight away, but it had it. Mario Galaxy was like, big, new Mario, boom, there's a fucking console shifter. New Zelda, boom. The Wii U's not had any big... They've got Mario Maker, which they could have easily released on the Wii. It's basically just like create... It's basically a little big planet, but with Mario, which is fine, but it's nothing amazing. Unless someone could point me to this big flagship game that they've got for the Wii U that's like the console seller.
Well, Zombie U, obviously.
Oh, yeah, that was mint, wasn't it?
Which what is now out on PlayStation 4 as well.
Zombie U?
Yeah, it was the release title, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I've never even heard of it.
Apparently, it's all right. It's got decent reviews, but yeah.
It's a first-person zombie smash-em-up game set in London, so it has that, you can beat up people dressed as the Queen's Guard, like, element to it.
There's a quote in this article: a huge seamlessly unfolding world is something that can't be achieved if the hardware isn't advanced enough. Now, I remember playing Elite on a BBC, which had an entire galaxy in it. So it's all about how you make the game, truly. It's nothing to do with the hardware.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I'm trying to find facts about why the Wii U's classed as a failure, because if you type that into Google, there's loads of articles about it.
Yeah, but if you type in why is the Earth flat, you'll get loads of articles about that as well.
Yeah, that's all the internet. But what I guess the point is that the other consoles, and Nintendo consoles themselves traditionally have had longer cycles than they've given the Wii U. It seems a bit odd that it's next year there's a new one coming out. It feels like the Wii U just came out.
Yeah, it does. When did it come out?
It can't be more than 3 years ago, unless I'm just... My sense of time has just gone to shit recently.
So 2013?
I don't even know what a Wii U looks like.
I don't know what the console looks like. I know what the gamepad looks like. I don't know what the console looks like.
That's because you never come round and visit me.
Have you got one?
Yeah.
Yeah. What does it look like, just out of interest? Does it look like a Wii U?
It's a Wii, but it's black and it's got rounded edges.
Cool.
I'm assuming there's a white one as well, but I don't have that one.
What's the best game you've got for the Wii U that you personally own? What's your favourite Wii U game that you own?
And what's its superpower? Proving our point here, Steve.
Yeah, I'll admit that there isn't a great array of titles out for it at the minute. Probably never will be. To be honest, probably the game I played the most on it has been the HD remake of the Wind Waker.
That's a problem though, isn't it? Because I've heard that that's great, but it is an HD remake of a fucking GameCube game. I mean, it should have more to offer than that.
It should.
Not that I'm saying that the Xbox One and the PlayStation 4 have got a shitload of great exclusives either, but they're not also talking about releasing the PlayStation 5 next year, so...
Well, the thing is, it's really unclear as to what the NX is.
Yeah, it's not even got a full name for it yet. Or is it an add-on thing? Is it a full name?
If you look at what Nintendo have been doing recently, they release a console, then they release a slightly better version of it, then they release a slightly better version of it. Look at the 3DS. We're on to the fourth generation of 3DS.
That's handheld, though, isn't it? They've always done that with the handhelds. The Game Boy was the same.
Yeah, but look at the Wii, then you had the Wii kind of Ultimate, then the Wii U, then you had the Wii U Premium.
Is the Wii U just a continuation of the Wii, though?
Not really.
Slightly different hardware, isn't it?
It is
completely
different hardware.
Isn't it?
But you can play Wii games on the Wii U.
All right, okay. Is it emulated, or is it like noticeably emulated?
It's emulated. It's on a virtual console.
Okay. You see, Nintendo are pushing the mobile market now, aren't they?
Yeah.
Now,
see, I think that the NX is going to have something to do with that. I think it's going to try and bridge the two together.
You think it might be, yeah. Like, they might be branching out into some kind of smartphone territory or...
Okay, all right. Sorry, Steve, I'm finding lots of figures here. I'm not sure where you're getting your figures from, but the Wii U has just sold 10 million recently, whereas the PlayStation 4... has already sold 30 million.
I didn't say it sold any better than the PlayStation 4.
Right, okay.
I said that over the recent months, with like Black Friday and what have you, a lot of outlets have sold a hell of a lot of Wii U's just recently. So if that's shown a surge for Christmas, or because people are expecting a new Zelda game or a new Mario game, I don't know, but apparently sales have spiked recently.
Okay, right. So so the PlayStation 4 is still outselling it. The Xbox One is Xbox One is kind of same as the Wii U. It's probably slightly less at the moment. But I think what makes it a commercial failure, from what I understand, is that it's not selling as much as Nintendo expect it to sell. Now, normally, and they're usually quite good at predicting these things, I believe. I mean, the Wii sold a hell of a lot of units, a lot more than I ever gave it credit for. What were we on? 101 million units.
That was partially the price point and partially the gimmickiness of it. And Nintendo were admirably confident about that machine. Like, they really pushed it and they really sold its virtues well.
It was the game that it crossed what's the one looking for? It crossed the gamer boundary into the, this is what the casual gamer thing came from, is that, you know, my mum had a bloody Wii, do you know what I mean? It's that kind of thing. She never bloody played a fucking game in her life. Suddenly had a Wii out of nowhere and was playing Wii Sports, and it's like,
Wii Fit,
okay. Yeah, where did this come from? Well, do you want to play fucking a proper game or no? Alright then. That's my snobbishness coming out.
By comparison, we've got the Nintendo DS, the original Nintendo DS that sold 154 million units, and the PlayStation 2 that sold 155 million units. But the Nintendo 3DS sold 54 million, so that puts the Nintendo DS well above, and all the other variations of those.
Yeah, but the Nintendo DS has been out years longer than the 3DS.
Yes, and if you look
and
at the Wii,
that's lifetime sales.
If you look at the Wii came out in 2006, PlayStation 2 came out in 2000. So we're, you know, the Wii U is essentially well beating it, you know, well beating, they're going to well beat the PlayStation 2. But you can't buy PlayStation 2s anymore, so.
Yeah, and I don't know, I mean, if it comes out for the Wii U, then I'll get it for the Wii U. If it comes out for the Nintendo NX, then I'll get a Nintendo NX.
Yeah, I mean, I'll get a Wii U eventually. I just haven't really been console orientated for the last year or so. Weird, very weird that I really went all out on consoles for a few years. But now I hardly play them. I haven't turned my TV on downstairs for probably about 2 years now.
Wow, Jesus.
I just... No incentive whatsoever. Played more stuff up here, doing streams with you guys. And that's probably the last time I played a console. So, any other news?
Should we move on?
There's one more.
Thrive, Spore's spiritual successor. Interesting.
That's what it's being about. Tagged as. Anyway, it's made by an... It's free, open source game that's been done by a load of volunteers. And it's supposed to be basically to get right what Spore got wrong.
It looks very muddy and rubbishy at the moment, doesn't it? But they're trying to get people on board who will make it better.
Yeah. And
in what way they're saying that it will fix Spore's problems? Because I can't really define what Spore's problem was.
Well, neither can I, but I remember being very excited by Spore, playing it, and being very disappointed.
Like, yeah, everyone was.
The whole kind of thing of nurturing something from a single cell organism right up through to something that, you know, can leave the planet. I like the idea, I really do. Go on, Chris.
I would say I totally agree with you. I felt very similar, but I did enjoy it at the same time. I enjoyed the... It just was a bit simple, especially things like there was the Civilization era. It wasn't complicated enough. By that point in the game, I wanted to be doing a lot more complicated stuff.
I think I know what you mean. It's like it felt like mini games rather than a full game. It was like you were playing lots of demos.
But you have to then implement different mechanics for every stage of the evolution, so you are asking quite a lot out of the game. If you look at it that way, if you want a full SimCity game at evolutionary level 5, then it's like, well, what's the... If you then go in Galactic, then how much more complicated has it got to get again? And essentially, you're asking for sequels to a game rather than elements of a game of itself. And that's kind of the problem, isn't it?
And it wouldn't have bothered me if they released Spore in several stages. I really enjoyed the cell level part of the game.
Yeah, and I enjoyed making my monster, making my original, whatever it was, the thing that come out of the sea. But after that, I don't know, it just got a little bit repetitive and boring. I never played the space stuff. I've got it now, but I never played it. Was it any better, space stuff?
Not really, it was just more of the same, to be honest.
Look at the textures on that.
It looks quite muddy.
I thought it was interesting, though.
It's definitely interesting. I'm always up for anything like this that... Ooh, is a version out now available?
Yeah, you can download it. It's about a 500 meg file.
Have you tried it?
I've downloaded it. I haven't actually played it yet. Otherwise, it would have been on what I played this week list.
Cool. Oh, I might download that now. Anyway, on that note, I think we've finished, haven't we?
Guys.
So, unless you guys have got any other business, thank you very much, everybody, for watching. And if you like anything we do, we're on YouTube, where we come on as many Wednesdays as we possibly can, although it hasn't been too many recently because we haven't been playing that many games. But we're on Twitch Live, 7:30 on Wednesday nights, 7:30 GMT. And you can catch us on YouTube. I do a few other videos and reviews and bits and bobs occasionally. I haven't done any for a little bit again because, you know, life and that, but there we are.
Chris also streams Fallout throughout the day.
Yeah, I haven't been over the last couple of days, but I have tried it a few times. Don't get that many viewers, to be fair, but, you know. Anyway, right, I'm going to get off. So, catch you all later.
See you later.
Tiddle bit.
Bye-bye.